Star Wars The Old Republic offers a generous free-to-play model where you can play all 8 of the game's original class stories and reach up to level 50 for free. Unlike other online games like World of Warcraft and Guild Wars 2, whose convenience restrictions exist to maintain the health of the game's economy, like restricting gold farmers and spammers, Star Wars The Old Republic's free-to-play model attempts to force-choke credit farmers while simultaneously reminding free-to-play players that they could be playing as a subscriber. In this video, I'm going to be going over all of Star Wars The Old Republic's main restrictions and discussing which ones I would like to be kept the same, changed, or outright removed from the game. Fair warning, this is a fairly in-depth video and it is quite long. If you're actually looking to learn about the restrictions in the game and how to use them, or if you're looking for tips on how to play as a free-to-play player, make sure to check the description of this video instead for some better videos for you. Let's start with the game's expansion content. Free-to-play players will not have access to the expansion's content for Star Wars The Old Republic, much like Guild Wars 2 players will need to purchase its expansions to progress. In Star Wars The Old Republic, the lack of expansion availability for free-to-play players means that once a free-to-play player has finished the main class story, there will no longer be any more progressive quests available to them. They can still go make new characters and play the other 7 class stories, but if they want to keep playing their main character, they will need to subscribe. Free-to-play players are also paused at level 50 and are unable to reach level 51, but level doesn't matter too much, and the main reason you want to level up is to do the more difficult high-level content anyway. Personally, I think this restriction is pretty fair. If you've reached the end of your class story and aren't speedrunning it, you've probably put in over 50 hours of free gameplay, and I think it's more than fair for the developers to request that you subscribe for at least 1 month after that. The restrictions that exist while playing a low-level character on a free-to-play account are what I really want to talk about. Some restrictions that currently exist are meant to prevent gold farmers and gold spammers, while others exist to encourage free-to-play players to subscribe. I believe that a player who has fun during their free-to-play trial of the game is more likely to subscribe to the game, so let's go over all of Sutter's restrictions and my suggestions about what the game should change. I've played over 50 hours on my alternate free account, and so far I've had a lot of fun. But I'm an experienced player, and I went in already knowing what the restrictions would be, and what I was getting myself into. So far, I have no major complaints about playing on a free-to-play account, but I think a lot of these restrictions would be surprises to new or returning players and may even discourage them from playing the game altogether. I believe the goals of the free-to-play system in Star Wars The Old Republic should be to make the leveling experience as enjoyable as possible, but heavily encourage the player to subscribe once they have finished their class story, or when they have reached level 50, and would like to try out endgame content like operations and frequent player versus player matches. One of the biggest problems for high-level free-to-play players is the credit cap. Free-to-play players may not hold more than 200,000 credits at a time. Any extra credits are locked away in a special escrow and are not available until the player subscribes. This also means that free-to-play players may never buy anything that's more expensive than 200,000 credits, while many armors, weapons, and mounts sold by players cost 500,000 credits or more. There are escrow items available that allow you to withdraw more from your escrow, but they're purchased with cartel coins, which most free-to-play players don't have. While it's extremely frustrating for free-to-play players being unable to buy most cosmetic items from the GTN, I think the 200,000 credit limit will have to stay until a new alternative method is found to prevent gold farmers and sellers using free-to-play accounts to earn money. This also goes for free-to-play players being unable to use mail, being unable to trade, being unable to withdraw or deposit credits in guild banks, and free-to-play players being unable to use general chat until level 25. These are all countermeasures against companies or individuals advertising their gold selling services. Although they're some of the most frustrating, these communication and currency restrictions in Star Wars The Old Republic are actually very similar to what other games have for their free-to-play versions, including World of Warcraft, Guild Wars 2, and Final Fantasy XIV. Another way I think Star Wars The Old Republic could really improve its free-to-play model without jeopardizing their game is by allowing players to purchase character and legacy unlocks with credits from their new legacy bank. The Legacy Bank is a newer addition to the game that allows players to deposit credits into their Legacy Bank, which can then be withdrawn by any of their characters on that server. Free-to-play players, at least the smart ones, can take advantage of the Legacy Bank by depositing their credits into their new bank anytime they come close to their credit cap. This is a nice addition, but still does not allow free-to-play players to make large purchases since they can still only withdraw up to 200,000 credits. I think it would be fantastic if free-to-play players could use these unlimited legacy credits to buy unlocks for their account, including the expensive convenience unlocks like Rocket Boost, Inventory Unlocks, Outfit Designer Slots, and Stronghold Unlocks. This way, free-to-play players still have credit-related goals that they can strive towards without the risk of those credits being able to enter the economy. An alternate to this plan could be allowing players to hold as many credits as they want, but only being able to spend a limited amount on the GTN via trading or via mail. For example, only allowing a player to buy, trade, or mail up to 200,000 credits. Another improvement that could be made to the escrow system is to remove the escrow system altogether and instead make all credits earned over the credit cap go directly into a player's legacy bank. That way, a player still can't make GTN purchases over their credit limit, but they will always have access to the credits they have earned via their legacy bank instead of having them locked away and held for ransom with the escrow system. I've heard many, many players request that the credit cap simply be raised to a more reasonable amount. Personally, I'm not sure if it should be raised, or if it should be, to what amount, due to a raised credit cap making life easier for those who want to take advantage of the gold selling system. If BioWare were to simply raise the credit cap, say to 1 or 2 million, companies and individuals would have a much easier time selling credits earned on free-to-play accounts. Having to subscribe monthly is a huge deterrent to gold selling, and dropping that deterrent and giving free-to-play players easier access to credits without making any additional changes to the game would definitely jeopardize the game's economy. You're probably already wondering, so Teresa, the game's economy is already pretty crazy and super inflated, how could this possibly make it worse? If more companies and individuals are able to start free-to-play gold farming accounts, a large swath of very cheap, close to unlimited credits will enter the market as players buy them against the terms of service. With more credits entering the economy, inflation will go way up, again even more than currently. And on top of that, players who don't want to have their account banned and want to play within the game's terms of service won't even be able to take advantage of this. They will simply have to buy those inflated prices with the credits that they earned in a normal and safe way. On top of seeing those negative changes to the economy, the GTN, credits, and to rare items, you'll also start seeing a lot of new characters in the world. Unfortunately, I don't mean new players, I just mean new characters. You'll likely start seeing a lot more accounts run by automated bots who are gathering credits to sell easily on their new free-to-play accounts. For those of you who used to play RuneScape, classic RuneScape, I'm sure you remember seeing chains of characters running around farming either wood or metal or whatever other material was available in the world. It really downplays the game itself, it makes it less fun because you know those are just automated bots, they really ruin immersion, and they also make it harder for normal, fair players to gather or collect things in the open world. So I'm sure the developers know that it would be a huge quality of life update for preferred and free-to-play players to be able to have a raised credit cap, but they have to do it in a way that does not hurt the game's economy and the game's gameplay as we just talked about. Now, if the credit cap cannot be safely raised, I think allowing players to at least buy character and legacy unlocks with their credits alone would be a huge improvement. It would also be a really neat news update to the game for players who haven't played in a while. Hey, come back, you can actually use all those credits that you had stocked away to come check out the new strongholds, get these new legacy boosts and character boosts that are available, so on and so forth. They're no longer locked away in escrow just as badly. Maybe there's a way to safely raise the credit cap just for certain players. Maybe players who have reached legendary status or finished other long-term achievements could have the credit cap removed. Not those easy-to-make free-to-play accounts. Whether or not the credit cap can be safely raised relies on data that we as players don't have, including all the most recent ways gold farmers and sellers take advantage of the game, and statistics about how raising the credit cap might affect the game's economy. Now let's talk about the restrictions I think should be left in place for free-to-play accounts. Character slot limits. Free-to-play players are limited to 4 characters per server. The original limit was 2, which felt very low, but now you can have a total of 20 characters across all servers, which is more than enough to try all the classes with plenty of character slots to spare. Operations. When the game became free-to-play, unsubscribed players could buy special access passes from the cartel market or from other players that allowed them to play operations, sometimes known as raids, even if they were not paying for a subscription. This option has since been removed from the game, but I'd really like something similar to be reintroduced. I believe it was removed because players decided it was a good alternative to subscribing, including myself, I did that as well. So they or other players would buy the pass using free cartel coins, which allowed players to play for free compared to when they were originally subscribing monthly. Instead, I would like some type of token that allows players to purchase a subscription and then sell that token to other players. But make sure this token cannot be bought with cartel coins, as many cartel coins can be obtained for free via subscribing, cartel coin achievements, referral codes, and security keys. That way, BioWare still gets paid the full price of that player's subscription. World of Warcraft actually has a very interesting subscription token system. You can buy a subscription token for about $20 USD and put it up for sale for in-game currency. You cannot directly give it or sell it to another player, but other players can buy it. What's especially interesting though is that other players can buy with in-game currency called gold, but they can also buy the token with gold and resell it back to Blizzard for about $15 USD. Because Star Wars The Old Republic is such a social game, I'd really like to see this system added so you could buy and sell subscription tokens, but also add an option to be able to gift one directly to a friend. I think players could really benefit from this system, both players who have more time than money, for example students or younger people who have lots of credits and time to grind in-game, and players who have lots of money in real life and would like an easier time getting credits to do whatever they want with in-game. Players already have a similar system of trading credits for real-world dollars by buying some of the more popular items on the cartel market, but that is really tainted because of the free cartel coins that I mentioned earlier. This type of token would have to be outside the main cartel market system. Credit cost and credit gain. Things bought in-game are more expensive for free-to-play players than subscribe players. Honestly, this was a restriction I barely even noticed when playing on my free-to-play account, and is a nice perk for subscribers. Subscribers also earn 20% more credits from quests than free-to-play players. I also didn't even realize this until I was making this video. I felt I hit the credit cap of 200,000 credits at almost every planet from doing all the quests available on my free-to-play account. I don't need more credits, I can't hold them! Support. Free-to-play players have a lot less customer support options than subscribed players. Personally, I think this makes sense, it's okay. Unfortunately, a lot of players aren't aware of the different options that are available. Free-to-play players have these options. They can phone in if they have problems accessing their account or paying for a subscription. Unfortunately, the main customer support page kind of makes it sound like free-to-play players have zero phone calls available for customer support. You can definitely call even if you're free to play if you need help getting into your account, for example your password, your security key, issues with your credit card or paying for a subscription, anything like that, like the very basics of being able to play the game, you can call customer support. Just don't try and call them because your cape's upside down or you can't get to your next quest because you can't figure out how to Google it, stuff like that. They don't care, they won't help you. They'll help you if you're subscribed, sometimes. Free-to-play players also can get support via email, the customer support email, and via the EA official SOTOR forums. This is actually a fairly new thing in the last few years. Players used to not be able to post on the official SOTOR.com website, but they can post on the EA help forums now, which is awesome, but it is not a well-known option yet. In addition to email, phone, and forums, subscribed players can also place an in-game ticket, and this is what they use when your quest is bugged, when your armor is bugged, when you accidentally sold your favorite pet and can't get it back because the vendor won't give it back to you, stuff like that. Stuff that's not dire to you being able to play or not play, and free-to-play players don't have access to that. I think that's fair. Customer support does need to be paid. They're real people who earn a wage and someone has to pay for that, so I figure it's fair that free-to-play players don't really have that option, but I'm really glad they do have the option of being able to get into their account. But it can be very frustrating if your quest got stuck or something and you can't do a side quest and you're on a free-to-play account. I guess it is what it is. Species. The additional species in the game are pretty cool, like the red-skinned pure-blooded Sith and the well-known Twi'lek species. I think this is a fair restriction for free-to-play players. I'd actually even be okay if free-to-play players were restricted to only humans. Right now they can play humans, cyborgs, and Zabrax. To balance this restriction, I think it would be great if all players had access to all species, instead of the mix-and-match availability that is currently different for each class. For example, new subscribers cannot make a Chiss Jedi, the blue-skinned people, but they can make a Chiss Imperial agent without having to get into any special unlocks. This change could even be tied in with the current storyline of the Empire accepting more alien species into its ranks, and the Republic has forged many ties with Imperial characters during the expansions. Now here's the part where I'm going to go off script and just let you know exactly how I feel about some of the other restrictions. These are the ones that I do not think encourage players to subscribe, but instead simply discourage them from playing. These are also some of the ones that I have heard through my various communities, through the comments that you guys post all the time in my videos, through the SWTOR subreddit, through the official forums, through SWTOR Twitter, through SWTOR Facebook. These are the ones that you guys have said that you hate the most as a free-to-play player and will make you want to smash the game. The number one most hated free-to-play restriction is the lack of quick bars in the game, and this is the one that I've seen made the most fun of in social media, and it really feels like Star Wars The Old Republic is shooting themselves in the foot by not having these available even to free-to-play accounts. So your quick bars are the bars on the screen that allow you to put your abilities into slots and be able to see them and use them. Free-to-play players are limited to two quick bars, two bars that have their abilities on them, each one with about 12 abilities each. While 2 is totally fine for the first, 30 levels, once you start getting into the 40s, you keep having to switch out abilities that you don't need or can't use or are less important. You can't put fun little stuff on there like your quick travel abilities, your fleet pass, your mount. I've been having trouble switching my mount off and on because I wanted to try out different abilities, but I didn't have place for them on my free-to-play account. For comparison, preferred players, so players who subscribed in the past, are locked to 4, and full subscribe players are locked to 6. On my trooper, my main character, for some reason the Vanguard trooper doesn't need a lot of abilities compared to the other class, I use all 5 of them. I use for just my abilities, and the 6th one I just have mounts and fun stuff, but my character has the least amount of abilities, I think, compared to a lot of the other classes, which are going to probably need like the full 6, the whole shebang. And if those classes need all 6, can you imagine trying to make do with just 2? Like I said, I'm at like level 40-ish on my character, and I'm already running out of spaces. It's ridiculous that there should be a restriction on playing the basic part of the game that is the most frequent part of the game, which is combat. Just to be fair and clear though, I'm not having any actual combat problems on my free-to-play account. I've mentioned in some of my other videos, the combat system is very easy, so I'm still just demolishing everything in my path, but I really have to pick and choose which abilities I want to be able to use. They're all available to me, I just can't fit them on my bars. That's silly. Delete that one. Remove it. Stop having people make fun of you in every nook and cranny just for quick bars, which are an easy fix. One of the reasons they've mentioned they've never really given a rehaul to the free-to-play system is that it takes time and it takes development time, and it takes away from time they could be using to make actual new content. A really easy fix for this one, I think. They could just mail all new accounts 4 free quick bar items, because there's actually an item that's an unlock that you can buy on the cartel market, so just take that item, email it to all new players as a promotion, and then no one has to make fun of the game anymore for lack of quick bars. Done. Okay, let's move on to the second restriction I really think they should remove. And this one's kind of funny because it's more perception than an actual problem. Players who are playing on a free-to-play account receive less experience than players who are subscribed. It's about 20% less, I think. So the way it works is you level, everyone levels as normal up to level 20, and once a free-to-play account reaches 20, they receive less experience as they level than a normal player would. But oh my god, right now in the game, experience is not very well balanced, I guess you could say. The way I'm playing in my free-to-play account, I'm doing every quest in the game, and I am going to be almost level 50, and I'm not even close to being done my class story, and I'm not even close to the point where you should be getting to around level 50. Like, in the beginning of the game, when I first started the game, when it was launched, I remember doing all the quests available in the game, every single one, and I still wasn't even max level yet. I still wasn't 50. I had to go repeat some other stuff, do some group missions on the side, do some dailies on the side, stuff like that, until I was able to get 50. Woohoo! Now I'm going to be 50 about halfway through my story, I think. So experience is really overblown in the game right now, and experience gain is not really an issue. Which is really interesting because players who have not played recently or players who have not played yet get really turned off by this restriction. They hear it and they're like, oh, I see. Star Wars The Old Republic treats its free-to-play players badly by giving them less experience. I doubt they say it exactly like that, but that's the kind of conversation that goes on in their head and kind of leaks out in comments and stuff like that. And it's really funny to say, no, it's actually not an issue, but it's hard to believe when it's like one of the things that's very obvious that happens when you're playing on a free-to-play account. When I dinged level 20, I was actually in a boss fight and it was really cool. I was fighting with my whole group and this pop-up pops up saying, you reached level 20, you're gonna get less XP now, congratulations. Seeing as experience is not hard to gain anymore, I would just remove that restriction and guess what? Happier free-to-play players, more people willing to try out the game. Ta-da! Artifact authorization is the third one I'd really like removed. So when the game first came out, you would earn gear through various ways. You could do operations, and even if you're free to play, you could use those operation passes that I mentioned. You could get it through player versus player. Even now, you can PvP with a friend unlimited as long as they're subscribed. Free to play is locked down to 5 matches per week. And there were various other ways that you could earn gear over time, various different types of tokens, currency systems, blah blah blah. However, free-to-play players could never wear the best endgame gear in the game because of the artifact authorization restriction. Long story short, you couldn't wear any gear with a purple border, which was usually the best gear you could wear at the time. Regardless of your level, a purple item around your level would be way better than a green item around your level. In the olden days, this was actually more of a restriction for endgame. There really wasn't a lot of purple items while you're leveling. You'd pick one up here and there, and you'd just be like, oh, a purple item, cool, you know, not a big deal. But the real restriction came for endgame, that was what mattered. With endgame gear now being quite restricted to level 70, which free-to-play players can't even get at all, I think it's very important to remove this artifact authorization restriction. So the way I experienced it on my free-to-play account is that you really don't get a lot of that special purple gear, but I did get some when I ran some flashpoints with friends, and flashpoints are probably some of the more difficult content a free-to-play player will run, and that purple piece of gear is probably a pretty nice reward, and it shows up in your inventory. It's got a nice little purple border, and it's grayed out, and you roll over it, it's got a tooltip, but it's not super clear why you can't even wear it in the first place. It's not as aggressive as some of the other restriction messages. It's just like, oh, I can't wear this? Okay. At this point in the game, I'd really like them to remove it just because it's not really serving its purpose anymore. It's just a restriction that's probably annoying people, not actually encouraging them to subscribe at endgame anymore. Get rid of it. Goodbye. Let's talk about some of the cosmetic options. This is where I think Star Wars The Old Republic gets a bit petty when it comes to the restrictions. They're not necessarily encouraging you to subscribe. I really feel like they're just kind of shoving it down your throat that you're a free-to-play player. Free-to-play players cannot unify the colors on their armor, so if they have red pants and a blue shirt, they can't make the whole outfit blue like subscribe players can. They can't show or hide their helmet, they can't flick the toggle for that, they can't show or hide specific titles or play with their legacy names, and all three of those things, do you really think someone's going to subscribe because of the fact that they can't unify their colors? Especially these days, there's so many options when it comes to outfits, it's really easy to get something going together that you don't even need to worry about those restrictions. Personally, on my free-to-play account, I haven't even worried about them at all. I just find a cool outfit that matches itself, or find a helmet or hood that I like the look of already, and I don't worry about my title at all. I don't even know if I ever even looked at it. But I think these are, once again, three that should be removed because they're no longer as important anymore. I remember back in the day, it was a lot harder to get gear. I was running around on my trooper when I'm giving that red pants, blue chest piece example. That's an actual thing. Like, I had a green helmet, yellow boots, and some orange gloves to go with it. So you really needed that unify colors option, and these days you don't, so just remove them. Another important one is the personal bank, the green bank, and this is a very interesting restriction. So when you pick up any items that are bound to you, for example, you can't trade or sell them to another character or another player, you have to keep them in your inventory, basically, as a free-to-play account. Over the years, better options for storage have actually been added to free-to-play accounts, and that is awesome! Free-to-play players now have access to a legacy bank, which means anything that is legacy-bound, so bound to your account, or on your server, or not bound, so like crafting materials, companion gifts, stuff like that that you can buy and sell to other players, can go in that bank, and it actually saves a lot of trouble. It's a really nice addition to the game, both for free-to-play players and normal subscribers too. And now it's kind of weird that free-to-play players don't have access to that personal bank. One of the problems that I'm going to be running into soon on my free-to-play account is that, let's say I got a cool Jedi robes from a quest, or Sith robes, I have to keep them in my inventory or throw them away. There's not really another option for me to put them in. That personal bank is where they would go. I'd like them to remove that restriction, especially since the legacy bank exists. It's kind of silly that you can't get to the personal bank anymore. Let's talk about crew skills. So crew skills are the crafting in Star Wars The Old Republic. You can get crew skills that make things, so actual crafting skills, like you can make Jedi robes, lightsaber crystals, blaster rifles, stuff like that. And the other ones are gathering skills, so you can gather rough, raw crystals, or you can go gather scraps of metal and stuff like that that you would feed into your actual crafting skills. To be the most efficient on one character, you would want two gathering skills that match up well with a crafting skill. So if you're making blaster rifles, you'd want to get the one that you gather metal with and the other components to make blaster rifles with. So here's how the restrictions work. A true free-to-play account is limited to one crafting skill. So if they want to really maximize their crafting and be able to be very self-reliant without having to buy any materials from other players, you'd need to have a gathering skill on one character, a gathering skill on a second character, and the crafting skill on the third character, and I don't know, you could use your fourth character on that server to do whatever you wanted, I guess. In the past, because people were limited to two characters on a free-to-play account, it was pretty much impossible to efficiently craft for yourself. Now, with the limit being four, which is really nice, you can technically do all the crew skills yourself, but it's just kind of silly and annoying, I guess you could say. This is once again something that I don't think really encourages people to subscribe, but just kind of annoys them and shoves it down their throat that they're free-to-play. What's even funnier is if you've ever subscribed in the past and you're coming back to the game as a preferred player, basically a player who's ever paid money into the game, you'll have two crafting skills available. But what's extra funny is if you use anyone's referral code. So if you've ever subbed in the past, you can use a referral code and get your third crafting skill for free. So technically, for preferred players, there's not even a restriction, but only players who are kind of clever and know about that thing can do it, I guess. Next restriction, Flashpoint rewards. So a lot of players think that you can't play Flashpoints often, the dungeons in the game, as a free-to-play player. You can actually run as many Flashpoints as you want as a free-to-play player, as many dungeons as you want, but you only get the reward from the Flashpoint from the last boss 3 times a week. It's kind of a weird restriction, especially since the gear that drops, you probably need artifact authorization, the thing that allows you to wear the purple bordered armor. You might even get those rewards and not be able to actually equip them. It's a pretty silly and strange restriction. I think they're always dealing with a kind of tough balancing issue. They want to give people more options to play group content so that subscribing players have more people to play with, but they always want to make sure not to give too much, that people can just play for free without ever thinking that they should need to subscribe. That's kind of what happened with Operations. It got to a point where people felt they didn't need to subscribe, so it was removed, that option. So I don't know what they'll end up changing this to, if they ever change it. I don't know if people will become restricted to only so many Flashpoints per week, or if they'll just take away this reward restriction. Personally, I think that would be the best one. I don't think anyone would even notice that they get only 3 rewards per week. I doubt most casual players even run Flashpoints more than 1 or 2 times a week, especially if you're doing group Flashpoints. It can be really hard to get a group together. It's especially harder if you're on a free-to-play account. You probably play a lot less. Here's another kind of random one. This might be more in line with the restrictions we talked about, restrictions on currency and restrictions on communication. Players can place items for sale on the GTN, the Galactic Trade Network. Free-to-play players can place a whole 2 items for sale on the GTN. Preferred players can place a whole 5 items, and subscribers can place 50 items, which is mostly enough unless you're trying to run a trade empire, which some people do, but for the most part, players are fine with 50. It's kind of interesting that free-to-play players can place anything for sale on the GTN. I don't know if I necessarily want this removed, but if it doesn't hurt anything when it comes to gold spammers and gold sellers, I would like it removed just because it's like, what? Why can you only place two? Why not zero? Why not 10, you know? Quick travel! Boo! Hiss! Quick travel! Oh my gosh! Okay, so I had a really fun time. I was speed leveling with a friend the other day, and we were just trying to get to the cool Jedi cutscenes where you make your lightsaber, so we are rushing through everything, and quick travel is awesome! We are able to quick travel around from location to location and just kind of do the main storyline, and that's been one of the things that I really like about the game that's changed. You can really just do the main storyline a lot quicker and less travel time than you could before and just enjoy the best part of the game. And so the quick travel time, the restriction for subscribed accounts is 6 minutes. So every 6 minutes you can quick travel. So that means pretty much every other quest you could quick travel to the next location. It saves a lot of walking time if you don't want to explore the scenery or if you've already done it before. For free-to-play players, it's 26 minutes. Seeing as I play about an hour and a half every week, that's a lot of restrictions. That one I'd really like removed. That one felt like it was really kicking me while I was down on my free-to-play account. Oh, a restriction I really want removed is the revival restriction. Oh, this one made me so angry when I was playing on my free-to-play account. So when you're playing the game as a normal subscriber, if you die, no worries, you don't have to be respawned far away or anything like that. There's two options. You can be respawned where you are and have a few minutes of stealth to run away and go hide so you can continue your quest. Or you can be respawned at a medical center that's maybe a far walk away. And it can be really frustrating if you're getting your butt kicked and you die a couple times. The timer for how long you can respawn in place gets longer and longer. Like, this maybe happens to me fairly often in in some fights, and so let's say you die the first time, no worries, respawn. Die the next time, you have to wait 10 seconds to respawn in place. Die the next time, you have to wait a minute, and get up to like something crazy like half an hour, because they don't want you just banging your head against the same fight over and over and winning by luck. They want you to go and learn more, get better gear, or go do some other area first. But for free-to-play players, that revival in place is not a timer that ticks up. Instead, it is a finite number of 5 revives in your entire game to be able to revive in place. My first one, I already used on my free-to-play account, and I didn't even realize what it was. I thought it was just like 5 in this area, or 5 until I level up, or something like that. And yeah, so now I only have 4 revives in place for the entire game, and I think I've been even scared to use them, because I feel like I need to save them for a point where I'd be less annoying to group members, or it'd be less annoying to me to continue a long fight. So I mostly just return to the med center, and it just adds kind of unneeded travel time. And it's kind of crazy because, as I mentioned before, I think players should most be encouraged to subscribe once they reach level 50 or ended their class story, and me having to run extra miles on the Tatooine deserts, it just kind of pushes me farther away from finishing that class story, farther away from ever wanting to do the expansion story, because it takes me so much longer. Now here's a funny restriction that's actually made fun of a lot by subscribers and free-to-play players. So mounts in the game, like being on a speeder, on a car, on a horse, whatever. There's obviously no horses or cars in Star Wars, but there is equivalence. And those speeders, you were not able to get them very early in the game. When the game first came out, you got them really late, and even the upgraded versions, you maybe couldn't even afford for a really long time. They were so expensive, and they were very special to have. These days, Star Wars The Old Republic has embraced the idea that people maybe don't want to spend a year in the Tatooine Desert, and have made it easier to get mounts. I think subscribe players get them quite early in the game, and free-to-play players get them quite late. And although a free-to-play player may never really know the difference, a player who is returning to the game, who played in the past and had that convenience of having a speeder early in the past, it really sucks for them not to be able to have it early as a preferred player. Here's another ridiculous one that can just go in the garbage. So sprint, the ability to run faster around the map, happens at level 10 for free-to-play players and at level 1 for subscribed and preferred players. Please, just let us run at level 1! Yes, yes! Level 1 through 10 is the initial part of the storyline. It is basically the entire first map. I believe the main reason that it's at level 10 is because when the game was subscribed only, level 10 was the level you were supposed to get it. The maps are smaller, they're really not meant to be ran around as fast. But once again, this is one of those things that if you heard a preferred player or a subscribe player could start running at level 1 and you're like, man, how come I don't get to run at level 1? That's so dumb. That's another one of the things that I'd like to have removed. Once again, the longer it takes you to get through the leveling content, the less likely you ever are to get to the content that you'd subscribe for, the expansions. Here's another kind of a strange one. So there are space missions in the game. There is space PvP, player versus player, and even free-to-play players can actually, I believe, play as much as they want of those. And then there is solo space missions. The solo space missions are quite dated. They're on rails. A lot of players kind of laugh and poke at them, but personally I really enjoyed them, and I really enjoyed them especially as a newer player. I probably put a good 100 plus hours into them over time, and they're really fun to me. But free-to-play players are limited to 3 per week, and it's kind of a head scratcher to me because I don't think they're worth subscribing for. And it's just kind of a strange restriction. I don't think that's something that actually encourages someone to subscribe. So those I would also cut out. If Billy Bob wants to play 40 space missions a week for free, just let him. Billy Bob's never gonna get to the expansions. Don't worry about it. Just let him play. He can contribute to the economy with his space mission credits. Now here's one that's more annoying than anything else. So there is a dark versus light system in the game. If you played a couple years ago, you'll know that there was a dark versus light event. That's not what I'm talking about. This dark versus light system is a server-wide system. Everybody contributes to it, and the balance of the force kind of pendulums between dark and light, and the more dark and light decisions you do, or the more things you do in general, you kind of have to pick a dark or light side, and it changes based on what people are doing. And strangely, free-to-play players can contribute to the dark versus light system, like their choices affect the pendulum, and they get the big pop-ups about it, but they can't get any of the rewards because the rewards are for level 70. So I think it would be nice if, I don't care if they contribute, but it'd be nice if they stopped having all these random pop-ups about dark versus light. So now that we've gone through most of the restrictions and which ones I think should be kept, removed, or just changed, let's go over the general idea of how I think Star Wars The Old Republic's free-to-play version can be saved and really be used to upgrade the game. We know that they're working on an expansion for 2019, and I think this would be the perfect time to be able to include these changes and be able to boast, hey look, Star Wars The Old Republic barely has any restrictions for free-to-play. If you've been wanting to check out the game, now is the time, the perfect time to do it, and there's just been a huge expansion, so whenever you're done playing free, you can subscribe and you can, or buy the expansion, or however they're doing that, we don't know yet. But now, I'd really like to be able to boast and brag about Star Wars The Old Republic's free-to-play version. I already do brag a lot because it has the highest free trial out of all the games, I think, other than Guild Wars 2. You can get all the way to level 50, you can play all 8 of the class stories, and I personally think they're phenomenal, especially even compared to Guild Wars 2. I really like Guild Wars 2's gameplay and combat, but the story and the cutscenes have a lot to be desired compared to Star Wars The Old Republic. So what would I really like? I'd really like that long list of things, especially including the quick bars to be removed, the XP gain to be the same as subscribers, the artifact authorization to be able to wear purple stuff removed, to remove all the small cosmetic problems like unifying colors, toggling helmets and titles, to be able to use the personal bank again for free-to-play players, to remove the annoying convenience restrictions like the quick travel, the revives, getting the mount, sprint, stuff like that, and to just in general really revamp the system to make it fun and enjoyable to play the leveling during the game as a free-to-play player. Stop trying to tell me to subscribe while I'm just trying to do some basic missions. I'm still trying out the game. Even by the time I'm like level 40, I don't even know if I'm going to be playing the game long term enough or not. If you annoy me too much, I'm just gonna leave as a free-to-play player. Once I get to level 50 in my class story, if I've had a great experience, I'm obviously going to subscribe. And heck, even if I'm leveling, if I'm enjoying it and I'm not feeling too annoyed at the company, at the business, I might even subscribe halfway through as well. I've heard quite a few players like to do that too. They're like, I like the game, let's subscribe now. I think that if that happens during an expansion, that would be awesome. Another good thing to combine it with it would be some type of difficulty mode, because that is the second highest complaint that I've seen, that the combat is either too boring, especially at low level content, or too easy. And so I think it would be a huge boost to the game if they focused on removing those free-to-play restrictions and making leveling content harder, because there's tons of difficult content at endgame at level 70 for players who look for it. It's sometimes hard to find, it's not obvious in your face, but there's lots of great stuff like the Eternal Championship, the Master Mode chapters, and of course the more difficult group content too. So in short, how I think Star Wars The Old Republic can save its free-to-play model and really get ready for the expansion they're going to launch is to make the leveling experience more enjoyable. I think they've already done a lot of really good things to improve the leveling experience. For example, they've made it easier just to follow your main quest, and you don't have to do side quests if you don't want to, making all the speeder points unlocked, making the quick travel points easier to unlock, things like that make it a lot more fun to level, and I think really upgrading the free-to-play experience as well as making difficult combat options would be the absolute best thing for the game right now. And honestly, once they make those changes, I think leveling's in a really good spot. Like, I'd have pretty much zero complaints or suggestions between what they've already done and what I want them to do. I know this was a really long video. I hope you liked it. I hope the developers take these suggestions in heart. I'd really like to see which ones you'd really like changed in the free-to-play system, or what your thoughts are on Star Wars The Old Republic compared to other games that have free-to-play systems. I'd especially like to hear from those of you who have played the free versions of World of Warcraft, Guild Wars 2, or Final Fantasy XIV Online, or of course any other online games you like to play. This is a really huge rant video, but it is made out of pure love for the game. I really like this game. I wouldn't have a whole channel dedicated to the game otherwise. If you're not currently playing, I've got a video about, is Star Wars The Old Republic worth playing in 2019? I'll give you a hint, the answer is yes. Even with this huge long rant video, there's so many good aspects of the game. If you've already started playing, I've got a video called Tips for New Players. And if you're a veteran player, I've got tons and tons of guides about different topics in the game. Just pick your poison. If you want to show your support for this video, or to have similar videos show up on your YouTube homepage, subscribe to this channel. And as always, may the free-to-play be with you.